Right, thank you very much. I have too many slides, so let's get going with the slides. So who am I? Ran Nyman from Finland. Founding partner at GoSee company. Currently what I do, coach organization who move from complex world to more adaptable world. Do some trainings, large-scale scrum trainings, certified scrum trainer, I'll also do some scrum trainings every now and then. Mainly train and consult. Try to run some new business also, I'm gonna have time. All right, leadership. And how the leadership has created complexity in organization and how to avoid that complexity and how to move forward. So where does the complexity come from? This kind of a old thinking is there that it's coming from Taylorism. And Taylorism is coming from Frederick Winston Taylor's ideas of principles of scientific management. There he basically studied problems in 1900 pre-industrialization age and came up with the way of getting people to work. And his idea was that the managers tell people, the workers, what needs to be done. And this idea has then traversed throughout the organizations, and one of the extreme examples of this is this kind of Fordism that Ford created in beginning of 1900. His problem was that he has a car, lots of demand for the car, but no workers that could do the work, so split the work to really small parts, really well-defined roles, and the managers define what the workers need to do. So this is how it works. Luckily, we are not anymore there. But the ideas still exist in organization. So how can we see this kind of a modern Taylorism in current organizations? One way is that splitting of responsibilities. We have some people who promise something to the customers, and then we have others who actually have to do the work and deliver it. And there are other ways of splitting. Others know, and then we have others who decide without knowledge. Others plan, others then execute the plan. But it doesn't end there, it continues. There's a task and role specialization. We could have a project managers, quality managers, and people like that. But it doesn't end there. We have lots of roles. I showed this slide in United States, and they said that this is nothing. We have 700 specific roles only in IT. So this comes from this kind of splitting the responsibilities to really thin and having this kind of role specialization. Now, many of the organizations, they have found out we don't have enough people to fulfill the roles. So somebody came up with this kind of idea of functional managers, functional management role, meaning that one person can have many roles. And basically it leads that people are switching their hats. Basically now I'm the quality manager, and next I'm the project manager, and then I'm the release train engineer or whatever. It doesn't solve the problem, it still follows the thing that we try to split the work to really small parts. So what is then the everyday experience in this kind of organization? It's fragmented, we have narrow roles. But we have resource managers who push everybody so they have to work as fast as possible in organization, as much work inside the organization. So as a side effect, we have huge amount of batches there and queues for the people to work on. And because everybody is busy working on their queue, they basically learn narrowly to execute the things in the role specialization. So this leads to narrow learning. And outcome from the narrow learning is that more fragmented organization, because people specialize in more and more narrow parts. So what is the managers doing there? They manage the problems that we have between different roles, of course. And how do they manage people there in organization? Typical things is that you pressure people. You must do it. You are too slow. You prevent other people from doing it. So you put pressure. And everybody is busy working, the managers are busy, so you don't have time to do the real change in the organization. Everybody's just crawling in the floor and nobody has time to learn how to drive a bicycle. And as a side effect, when we have narrow roles for people, we have this kind of a feeling that the power and wisdom is always somewhere else, because you know only so small part. So how to get rid of that? our idea was this kind of actionable fearless leadership, to how to the leadership could change the system so that we could move on. So why do we need actionable fearless leadership? Is that if you don't do anything in this kind of organization, the work rolls downhill and people are just busy executing the work, and also the managers are busy. So as a fearless leader, you have to intervene. You have to stop things how they are going. But there are some constraining factors, and the constraining factors are how much time, how much trust, how much cash you have to do the change. So you have to balance which kind of intervention I do, balanced on the trust of the leadership, how much trust you have from the investors, and the constraining factors. One thing that prevents organization of change by needed fearless leadership is the fear. You are just one person there and you fear that the organization will crush you. There's individual fear for the persons, but there's also collective fear for the whole organization. Do we survive as an organization? And because you are afraid of things, you are afraid to create conflicts, so you try to avoid all the conflicts between the other people. But having conflicts is the only way of learning. What could be then the opposites of avoiding conflict? It's greed to learn. Or you could put it radical curiosity. Fascinating. How did this happen? How did we end up here? And try to investigate and learn from the current situation. So, fearless leadership. You have to trust in the learning and connect different realities and get rid of the fear so people are able to solve the conflicts. Also, you need to understand the system, you need to understand the Taylorism, the management thinking there behind, and how to create this kind of a organization where conflicts are able to be solved, like team-based organization is one solution for that. How to then create this kind of a organization that builds up from the feedback is that you need three kind of feedback from the reality. The first one is, of course, whatever you build, it delivered to customer, and customer has some complaints or some improvements ideas, or they are really happy about it. But you need the feedback from the customers. Then you need the immediate feedback from the technology, because it enables you to do the correct technological choices. And then there's the hard part that you need the feedback of the whole system and how it works and reflect the things. So how does it then work? We have a feature teams working on the whole product, getting feedback with the customers, solving the customer problems, continuous integration, continuous deployment, and then we have continuous experimentation. So we find out ways what works and doesn't work in our organization and we're able to change it. All right, lots of theory. Let's look at one of the large-scale Scrum cases where we implemented some parts of actionable fearless leadership. This is quite old case. It started already from 2004 when I was working there. It's a browsing gateway. They were running this kind of a 3 months incremental development, manual testing, individual component ownerships, no meaningful automatic testing, and then as a side effect, they have constantly late releases because the development phase was always on time, the design phase was on time, and the testing always took longer because you actually have to make it work when you start testing. So, actionable fearless leadership. The management realized that, okay, we have some problems, you have to try something else, and they decided, let's move to Scrum. Large-scale Scrum was the term was not known then. So, but they understood that if we tell people what they need to do, they don't really change. So they just decided as an organization, let's move to Scrum. But let people figure out what Scrum means for them. We support them, whatever they find, try to help them. So the first thing that needs to be done, you need to create suitable organization. And our organizational structure was like this. We have functional departments. We have a testing department, development department, specification department, And all the project always, of course, went across to the project, this kind of a department. So but the management did that we have to radically change things. They got rid of departments and moved to this kind of a cross-functional feature teams. And as a side effect, they created teams that are able to discuss with the customers and get direct feedback from what are the customer problems. And it looked something like this. We had the one product owner, one product backlog, many teams, each team had their own sprint backlog, and each team had their scrum master. Of course, we had to change where we worked. Traditional silo organization, we worked in this kind of cubicles, so we have to move the testing, development, specification in one around one table. That's on the other side of the picture there. This kind of a real collaboration. We got rid of this kind of manual builds. We need to put the continuous integration there. We found some obstacles there, but we were able to come over them. It was not really hard. Then the thing that was quite hard was to get rid of manual testing. Because it was an old product, we have a huge amount of test cases there, so we had to spend some time to automate them. But we managed to move pretty much totally away from manual testing. We had also lots of project manager managing there. We have the development project manager, testing project manager, customer project manager. So we decided that let's move to one product owner, focus on the real thing, and as a side effect, project managers were pretty much workless. So we didn't do anything with them. One of the project manager decided after half a year that there's no work for me, I leave. Other project manager find some other things to do in organization, and the third project manager helped in prioritizing defects. But yeah, that's how it went. All right, result in 2006, 2007, we started at the end of 2005. We had this kind of really great working spirit, really good committed teams, 100% test automation, and the product version 2.1 was released before planned deadline with all the features, not because we put all the features there, but because we have so good quality. After each print, we were pretty much in the shape of shipping it. As a timeline, it took a little bit less than 1 year to learn to get it working, but 2007 it worked really well already. So we have feature teams, full product focus, continuous integration, continuous experimentation. After each sprint, we have this kind of retrospective, overall retrospective, try to find experiments, how to improve things. The key thing why I show this presentation that's quite old is to highlight that large-scale Scrum is nothing new. We did it, start doing it already in the end of 2005. All right, from the fearless leadership point of view, what have we here then? The key thing was to build the feedback mechanisms inside the organization. So you are able to really get feedback from the technology customer and get it working. Psychological safety, this was one thing that was created by the organizational management by giving chance to the people to actually involved in the change. And Google has made this kind of a study of that what makes really productive teams. And they say that key influencing factor is the psychological safety. Already Edward Deming said that drive out the fear from the organization. So as a fearless leader, you need to create this kind of a secure environment where people are not afraid what happens to them. All right, actionable fearless leadership and large-scale Scrum, how do they tie together? So this was the vicious cycle, so you need to start from somewhere. The key thing where you start is try to attack the narrow learning. Try to learn new ways of doing things. So you need to change the thinking by fearless leadership and say that instead of focusing on narrow roles, let's widen the roles and try to learn wider why our system is not working. Out of that, you want to tackle next the fragmented organization, one way of doing that is create this kind of a organized for customer-centric learning, meaning feature teams, cross-functional, all of the people contributing to the product are working in one team. Let's create this kind of an integrated organization for you that it's not focused pleasing the managers, but focus on working with the customers. Now, next topic is the batch and queue, because the more queues you have in organization, the slower you learn. So you want to create their flow, that work is flowing and you're able to get feedback. And when you get real feedback, then are you able to learn even wider. And it sounds simple, but it's not actually, because the loop runs forever. You start from somewhere and then you have to learn forever. There's no ending. So if somebody said your large-scale Scrum adoption is ended, they're probably wrong, because it never ends, because you always learn new, better ways of doing things. As an it's kind of a fearless leader, what you need to do, you need to drive the change skillfully. And meaning that you create the feedback system, you create the organization that's able to solve the problems and work with the real customer problems. All right. This was the part of the leadership. Let's look at then what is the leader's role in understanding the complexity. And let's start by looking at collapse of complex societies and then link that to collapse of companies. Joseph Tainter has done excellent study. He has studied huge amount of different societies from the history, Mayas, West Roman empires, Egyptians, and his conclusion, he has basically concluded very simple way that what happened to the this kind of a civilizations. And you can look at this, I can share the story in brief. So when you start, there's a group of people, they come to some place, there are lots of food, lots of resources, so they start growing there. What happens then, they grow and grow, but how they grow is that they innovate and increase this kind of a local complexity of the society. You have a farmer, you create better ways of farming, you are steelsmith, you create better ways of forging steels, but you create local optimization, you form the guilds around farming, guilds around steel manufacturing, and it creates more and more complex different kind of sections in basic society. Now, when the complexity grows, at some point it grows to the stage that elite starts growing there, and elite starts creating wasteful rituals for themselves, like a priests, like agile coaches, an organization. They start creating this kind of rituals to maintain their status, they're an organization, but they don't bring so much value anymore. And then something changes around the society. New tribe emerges close to them, they attack. You are basically getting rid of some water resources, but you have created so complex society that it's no more able to adapt to the change. And the key point of the time there is that the root cause of the collapse is the internal complexity. You are not able to adapt anymore. And the outside thing that happens is just driving to across the thing that you have created for yourself. So how does this relate then to corporate world? There's one study done by Deloitte, and they said that complexity kills the profits, and I have one case where it kills actually the company. And what the Deloitte study says that companies, this kind of Forbes Global 500 companies, they are using $237 billion per year because of unnecessary complexity in their organization. All right, let's look at how complexity killed one of a company called Nokia Mobile Phones. Here is then the sad graph. From 2007 till 2012, top to bottom. 2007 was the best year ever for Nokia, and later on, after 5 years, it was losing money. Keep in mind, Nokia is a huge company. Nokia mobile phone is just a small part of it, and it doesn't exist. There still exist Nokia networks. They are growing strong and quite profitable still. So let's link this to Tainter's story. Nokia's opportunity in the beginning of 1900, lots of business opportunities, telecom mobile standards are opening, the GSM is running there, an ambitious leader who are basically aggressive, have a goal to grab the market. And talented engineers who actually make it work. So we are on the stage number one in Tainter's. We have lots of resources, lots of market to conquer. Let's go and just take the market. Step two, in the beginning of 2000, you have to look at the organizational background. The management practices in Nokia is based on 100 years steel and paper industry. They are not really understanding new product development. But this kind of just make it work. Engineers just make the product development work. They are innovative, they create local efficient solutions for their problems, but nobody is optimizing the whole. Complexity grows. Basically, Nokia keeps on adding 20% of new people every 5 years. It's a huge growing task. They are not able to train everybody, and they underestimate the software development challenge. The key focus is on sourcing radio hardware and manufacturing. And people learn their narrow roles, and they focus on creating really complex organization. And they also start creating the elite inside the organization who are trained and who are then becoming next managers and growing fast up the chain. So stage three, complexity grows, elite thrives there, they are happy, wasteful rituals, lots of management events, the designers in the organization, they have lots of fruits and tea and every morning fresh cakes, software developers just come to work and have to make it work somehow. 2007, they are in the coordination chaos. Nothing really moves in organization, just make it work. Engineers are pressured by large just make it happen managers, and they are not really able to respond to change in the market because their organization is too complex. Even they have all the skills in organization, it's just too complicated to be managed anymore. So it basically kills the whole Nokia mobile phones. And what's the status in 2016 is that they sold it to Microsoft, and Microsoft basically found out that it's impossible business and we cannot do it. And in December 2016, they killed the whole thing. All right. Let's look at then a short video about it, how it happens in the small companies. This was a story about big companies.
Is your organization stuck? You have many parallel projects ongoing, but nothing moves. Everyone is waiting for information, resources, or decisions. You spend your time in endless meetings, planning, and rework. You are experiencing coordination chaos. But how did you get there? Here we have Dan. He's heading a fast-growing software-based business. The company is growing using common sense. Everyone focuses on their specialty because that's what they were hired to do. And it seems efficient. Talented, enthusiastic people just make it work. The success is based on the informal communication network. Specialization works, and it becomes the unquestioned norm. So, whenever there is a problem, a new kind of specialist is hired or nominated. The number of specialists keeps increasing, and the complexity grows. In order to get things done, the company now hires a coordination specialist. Nina is the project manager. The business grows. More customers, more products, more specialists, more coordinators. The project managers, now headed by Nina, somehow pull it together. They become the heroes who squeeze value out of the messy organization. But the more the organization grows, the more chaotic it gets. Nina's project managers use the best processes and tools, but are not able to create results like before. The key people are torn between several projects. They are working days, nights, weekends, and holidays. They are burning out. Meanwhile, some other specialists are idling because their specialty is not needed at the moment. Experienced people start to leave. The organization has become too complex to be coordinated. The top management sits down to figure it out. Resources are not optimally allocated. The people should focus more on the projects and less on other stuff. We have to tighten the ship, clarify the roles and responsibilities, define detailed processes, measure and reward individual performance. This is what management consultants advise. Unfortunately, the management action breaks the informal knowledge sharing network, and things get even messier. More control and more bureaucrats, but less outcome. The company becomes slow and expensive compared to emerging rivals. The top management tries to find another solution. We still have a strong customer base, but the new competitors eat our profit margin. People are not productive and projects have become slow. We have tried everything, but we are powerless in improving the situation. Let's outsource the problem to a contractor specialized in providing resources. We can then control the contractor by commercial agreements. Nina has studied some lean and agile. She disagrees with the management plan. Dan sees the challenges with outsourcing. The problem is not about people. It is the system. Outsourcing the leadership problem would complicate things even more. But just using lean and agile best practices to improve the coordination does not solve the root cause, which is the over-specialization of the people and fragmentation of the organization. Dan sees the light. We need to think completely differently. The problem is our old thinking, where others think and others do, others decide and others coordinate. Some companies have taken another path. They trust in customer-oriented learning and cross-functional teams. Project managers are not coordinating plans and resources. The business decision-making is fast and close to the teams. This is possible for large corporations when the top management makes the suitable organizational design and truly supports the learning. There will be discovery, innovation, and business agility. It is motivating and builds a workplace where people stay and grow. Food for thought was provided by GoSee. More details at coordinationchaos.com.
All right, short video. You can rewatch it at coordinationchaos.com. And there's 5 minutes time for me. But let's go on and how to descale this kind of complexity using less in large organization. So we did some kind of a less adoption started 2016 in one huge insurance company, and we did it in very small part there. They were running this kind of a 3 month releases. They have lots of quality problems and things like that. So what did we do there? We found out that this kind of a simple less structure that we used previously doesn't work because they had too many people. So we have to basically use this kind of a less huge structure than I'm not gonna explain here because I have so little time. But basically, it's a way of scaling beyond 8 teams. So what they have done was that they have done this kind of transformation. They have this kind of traditional silos, but they were not in that situation anymore because they have done already these first steps and moved to this kind of a component-based teams. Basically, each of the team consisting of database specialist, UI specialist, and things like that. And they found out that this doesn't really work, and they wanted to have a better predictability, better view on the things, what are actually gonna done in organization, and they decided that to get this one, the current team structure doesn't really work. So they decided we need to move from the component-based teams to feature teams where the teams are cross-functional, so the teams are really working on something that we deliver to customers. So how do you move from this kind of a component teams to team-based organization? One thing we did there was this kind of a self-designing team workshop, and we have some pictures how we did it there. There are many ways of doing, so this is not the only way. One way, basically, you create this kind of a name badges for all of the people in the organization. You color code the testers, developers, scrum masters, business people in a different color, and then when they come to the workshop, you give them different colors so everybody knows who they are. And then you have a huge space where you have different locations where team members can create their own teams. And in the spaces where you need to create their teams, there's minimum setup for the team. And it contains a couple of business persons, a couple of technical guys, one testing, one scrum master. That's minimum setup. And then you can add there some more based on your needs. Then you invite the people there, you give them badges, and you basically show to them that these are the different product areas that we're going to work there. And your task is to figure out where you want to work, that and whom do you want to work, and what kind of problems you want to solve. And if you have some questions, these are the area product owners that you can ask more questions with. And after this kind of a 3 rounds of 30 minutes, people were able to create their teams. And here we have one of the teams. We can see all the name badges there. They are just coming up with the name for the team, and they are really happy with it. Really good way of involving all the people and getting commitment from the teams that you want to work with. Next challenge that, or the challenge that they actually want to tackle, was that they promised something to customer, but they didn't have any view. Are they able to deliver that? So we need to create the real product backlog for them and basically scrap their previous backlogs totally. So we invited all the people again in the same space and said that, hey, this is the way that we're going to do them. This is how we're going to split the current work in the new product backlog. And please do this kind of a product backlog refinement by this kind of area, help of the area product owners. And I have some picture how it goes here. The people are there. We have them on the board, all the user stories that needs to be split, analyzed, and test cases created. And then the outcome is like this. You have a huge amount of user stories, and they are basic for the product backlog. Now what you need to do after that, you need to do the release planning, and this is basically how you do the release planning. You take all the estimated user stories in one big room, you ask all the stakeholders, the product owners there, and you show them that this is what we are capable of doing. And all the stakeholders, of course, say that, hey, but this is too little, we are not able to do this and that. And then you say that this is the best that we could do. Then you need to do the sprint planning, and this is one way of doing it. Basically, you invite all the team representatives for one area. You put the stories there on the table, and you ask the team representatives, please pick them what you think your team is able to do. And all the user stories are known because the teams did the splitting already beforehand. So this is pretty much the selection of that. Results early 2017. We had their visibility, what was going on. We have the realistic plan that was communicated to customers. We were teams that were actually working directly with customer representatives, and test automation ramp up has been started. And it looks like that the first release that was delivered a few weeks back, it didn't contain so many defects, and it contains amazingly little defect, it looks like that currently, compared to previous releases. And then they have started their journey towards continuous delivery, but that needs huge amount of test automation there. All right, let's then wrap this up. Complexity, leadership, large-scale Scrum. Without leadership intervention, the natural way the organization grow, they become more and more complex, and you have less and less ownership there. So you need to create this kind of a suitable organizational structure that simplifies it. And one way of doing it is large-scale Scrum. But it's not the only way. It's one way of, you could pick some ideas out of large-scale Scrum. And this is large-scale Scrum huge picture, but this is even more important picture. You need to run some experiments, you need to have some principles, and then you maybe have some frameworks that you follow. I'm on time.
Thank you. It was interesting. So, any questions yet?
Thank you for the presentation. You had an interesting statement there earlier of 100% test automation.
Yeah.
Could you talk about that a little bit, and also about how important test automation is in, you know, getting that feedback
so
loop working faster?
Yeah. let's put it like this, there were no test cases done manually that were scripted. So everything that was previously scripted was automated. So we were able to automate everything that was automatable. There are always some test cases that you could automate, but there's a huge cost there, like pulling out the network cables while the software is running or something like that. You could create the robot for that, but we decided that maybe we run the test and somebody actually pulls the cable there when the test is running. And then you have some other thing. Importance of test automation, it's really important. It's a crucial thing when you're running this kind of iterative development. Otherwise, you are killing yourself with unsustainable testing effort. After each iteration, you have to rerun all the tests. Otherwise, you end up accumulating more and more defects there that you don't notice.
Mm-hmm. One question here.
Yeah, actually two, I hope. So you spoke about the system feedback, right? Is there some certain measurement type of figures which you can use to analyze the success of the implementation of the scaled agile? And the second question is just a bit more personal about the Nokia. I worked in some of their projects in those years, and actually both mobile and network part tried out less than safe, and it, yeah, as we see in some certain way did work or did not. So is there any measurement of the success of the system, how you can like tell whether it worked or not?
Measurement of success is, I would say, that how well you are able to adapt, how fast you are able to adapt on changes, on the technology, on the market, on the priorities. The faster you are able to adapt on the things that happen, the more successful you will be. No matter which framework you have there. And also limiting the cost of change. So having this kind of adaptability with ultra low cost. That I would measure success.
Okay. There's one more.
I have a question. All these teams are working for one product or for several products?
One product, that's because it's, let me continue, it's no sense of putting, if you have this kind of a one product only in organization.
Okay, that then teams I have next question. Do you have somebody who overviews all the project architecture and how it should work technically?
Is there anybody overviewing them? In many cases, there are many people overviewing them, but do they bring any value? That's then the totally different point issue. Because if they just watch what's going on there, it's not much value. If they create guidelines that nobody's following, that's not much value. If they really work there with the teams, trying to drive the technology in some direction, then there's a value on that.
Actually, my question is about, from my experience, we had different teams working independently, okay, in separate teams, but nobody seen how these products should work and interact each of the maybe sections, yes? Yeah. And how it works for you? Do you have somebody who knows all the, because everybody should can't know the architecture as a product.
So it's not trivial problem to solve, but it's not even not hard problem to solve. You need to put the teams to collaborate on technological solution, and there are many ways of doing that.
Okay, so you're
I'm not gonna go there in detail in the specific ways of doing that, because there are many ways of doing that. How to make teams collaborate.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, so I have a quick question to you.
Yeah.
You work as a consultant, and I know you've been doing things in Riga. So, any example of a company that has done self-designing teams in Latvia, in Riga? Self-designing workshops?
I don't know. Maybe there comes something.
You're not.
I don't remember. Let's see that I work with so many companies. I hear so many stories, and
okay,
it's really hard to put.
One more, but that's the last one. Quick one. Just one.
Yes, quick question about the teams. So, like, self-organizing teams like this workshop, how you avoid having, like, the team of superstars and a team of the shy people?
I don't think it's a problem if the team of superstars is really good and they like to work with together. Many cases, the superstars don't really work like to work together. So, but if you're able to, they select themselves, that's typically good. And then if you have a team of juniors, then it's okay, because they learn quite fast. Okay, maybe so you have to support them a little bit on learning, but if they select this kind of team by themselves, they probably understand that we are all the juniors and we need to learn a huge amount of things. But yes, we're going to make it.